If you or your patients feel pain deep in the butt, there's a good chance that they will end up with the diagnosis of piriformis syndrome. In this video, we will explain why it's not piriformis syndrome 99% of the time, what the actual causes might be, and especially what to do about it.
Check out our online courses now. The link is in the video description.
Hi and welcome back to Physiotutors. The piriformis muscle runs from the sacrum to the hip joint. Due to the fact that the sciatic nerve runs underneath it, it was suggested that a tight piriformis might compress the sciatic nerve and cause pain in the buttock and the back of the leg. Researchers have even found anatomic variations where the sciatic nerve runs directly through the muscle, leaving the sciatic nerve even more susceptible in theory. However, there are more anatomic structures that could potentially compress the sciatic nerve, like the gemelli obturator internus complex, the hamstring muscles, fibrous bands containing blood vessels, vascular abnormalities, and space-occupying lesions. For this reason, experts now prefer the term deep gluteal syndrome. Independent of how we want to call it, why do we say that it's not piriformis syndrome then? Here are three strong arguments. Number one, a study by Bartrett et al. In 2018 examined 1,039 adult hips on MRI, of which around 20% had sciatic nerve variants that might make the sciatic nerve more susceptible to compression by the piriformis muscle. They found no relationship between sciatic nerve variants and piriformis syndrome. Number two, piriformis syndrome, by definition, is the compression of the sciatic nerve by the piriformis muscle. When a nerve gets compressed and irritated, patients report symptoms like pins and needles or loss of feeling and strength in the distribution of that nerve. Nerve pain usually has a burning, electric, or shooting quality as well. Most people, however, that we see in practice only have deep, aching buttock pain and no symptoms distal to the buttock and referred pain to the posterior thigh at most. So if the pain stays in the buttock area and has a quality different to nerve pain, how can the sciatic nerve be affected then? And number three, in patients that do actually suffer from real sciatica, only 6 to 8% are thought to have piriformis syndrome. This means that in a vast majority of cases, there will be different underlying reasons for sciatica, mainly nerve root compression due to lumbar disc herniations or foraminal stenosis. In many regards, the diagnosis of piriformis syndrome in the lower limb is comparable to thoracic outlet syndrome in the upper limb. The diagnosis makes sense from an anatomical point of view, but both are diagnoses of exclusion and highly debated by experts in the field. In patients that do finally undergo medical imaging or surgery, most cases turn out to be caused by nerve root compression. So how can we perform a structured diagnosis for piriformis syndrome? First, make sure that your patient suffers from symptoms of nerve compression. So he or she describes pins and needles, a burning sensation, possible loss of feeling and strength, or shooting pain in the distribution of the sciatic nerve, which runs all the way down the backside of the leg into the foot. If this is the case, you first need to rule out lumbosacral radicular syndrome. Check out our playlist with videos that can help you with that by a click on the info button in the top right corner. After ruling out radicular syndrome, we would continue with provocation tests that stretch or contract the deep gluteal muscles in an attempt to elicit sciatic nerve pain. Of course, we have an extensive list of provocation tests for piriformis syndrome on our channel as well. In case your patient only reports buttock pain, there can be a huge variety of underlying pathologies, making a diagnosis very challenging. Here's an overview by Gomez, Hoyos et al. In 2018 with possible underlying reasons for posterior hip and buttock pain. Our first priority would be to examine the lumbar spine, which commonly refers pain into the buttock area. The sacroiliac joint can also be a driver of nociception. the cluster of lacelet, can be helpful in making this diagnosis more or less likely. For the other diagnoses, you can find videos on our channel. Now, let's move on to what we most commonly see in practice, which is muscle pain in the deep gluteal area, also called myofascial pain. A way to confirm this diagnosis is to have the patient stretch and contract the deep external rotators of the hip, which should elicit symptoms deep in the buttock. Furthermore, manual palpation of the deep gluteal area should elicit recognizable pain by the patient. Make sure to compare both sides, as basically everyone will report pain if you just poke hard enough. So what is the reason that muscles become painful? Like mentioned in earlier videos, in most cases muscles become tight because they are weak and the demand placed on them is higher than their capacity. Be aware that psychosocial and environmental factors can also have an influence on a patient's pain experience. So, a patient's pain threshold could, for example, be lowered by stress, lack of sleep or decreased sleep quality, anxiety, depression, and so on. There's quite a variety of options targeted at short-term pain relief, like manual pressure and massage in the painful area, dry needling, heat, and rolling with a foam roller or tennis ball. Another short-term option is to stretch the deep gluteal muscles. Here are two stretches that you might want to try at home. While those are all optional, our recommendation for short-term pain relief is to decrease activities that are aggravating your buttock pain. Avoid prolonged sitting or standing and try to change positions as often as possible, as our muscles really don't like static postures. Sitting on a well-cushioned pillow can make sitting a bit more bearable, and having a pillow between your legs when you're lying in bed can reduce prolonged stretch on the gluteal muscles. If running or walking is painful, temporarily decrease your running or walking volume to tolerable levels. Like mentioned in other videos, the only real long-term solution to muscle pain is a progressive exercise program that targets the painful area. With all exercises, make sure that pain levels are tolerable during the program. If pain increases afterwards, make sure that the pain settles within 24 hours. If this is not the case, try easier exercises or decrease the number of sets and reps. Here's an example of a progressive exercise program, starting from easy to more advanced exercises. These exercises are tolerable, you can move on to heavier, more global exercises, such as okay, this was our video on pain in the butt and why it's not piriformis syndrome in 99% of all cases. If you still believe that your patient has piriformis syndrome, check out our orthopedic test playlist for this condition right next to me. As always, thanks a lot for watching. Head over to physiotutors.com for more valuable content, and I'll see you in another video. Bye.